opening hier. And you look straight down. Have a look. Otherwise it's gonna be a rather immaterial. What do you see? I haven't seen it, so.
Shirts and a piece of cement.
Oh, okay.
No, it's the one above.
Yeah, there's one.
I see nothing. I also see some sort of a.
You see my foot, probably.
Well, actually, I see a piece of straw. Oh,
okay. Okay, so this is called the optical.
On the edge of this.
Yeah, yeah. This is called the optical plummet. So it looks through the instrument and it looks straight down to the point where you are. Have a quick peek.
Okay.
Give it a stick. We didn't need it for a while.
Yeah, okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So our assignment is, if you want to measure something and you want to make it into a map of course is a horizontal flat piece of paper. And by convention, that piece of paper is in a horizontal plane. Right? So you want to measure things on the horizontal plane from this point. So you want to have this thing horizontal and you want to have it over that point. Right? This is a little trick how to do that. So first you look where you are. Let me see where we are. Okay, then you move this thing, you just move it until you can see the spike. You want to be over this little spike. Okay, then give it a try. You have to move the whole instrument, all the legs and everything. You have to look in here, otherwise you can't see what you're doing.
Okay, I'm going to move it while my eye is on the thing.
Well, otherwise you don't know what you're doing.
Well,
it will move. You have to move it a little bit. It's like this much. It's like, okay. Like 4 inches in your lingo.
Your lingo.
I would say 10 centimeter, but.
Okay, still long.
Okay.
No, I'm just making it taller so I can't see.
Yeah, the key thing is if you work all day on something like this, you have to put it up yourself at your height, because it is very awkward if it is too low, and even more awkward if it is too high. There has to be at the right. I think you're moving way.
No. I can see the 6 and the 8.
But you're moving too far towards eco. If you look at the thing, it's kind of starting to tilt. So you have to find another. No. This.
It has to be straight.
It will be straight at the end. So don't worry.
Yeah.
But we don't want to topple over.
Okay, I can kind of see it.
What does it mean?
It means it's in the top of the view.
It is. Let me move it a little bit back. So.
You may want to bring it down a little.
Even more? We step on it so it doesn't move it either. Let me drop it down a little bit more, so for Caitlin's purpose. That's alright, I always put it very high because I'm a tall guy. Can you step on that? This one is a bit stiff. Oh wow! Let me fool around a little bit. Okay, look at this thing now. What do you see?
I see the thing and it's almost in the middle.
Almost in the middle. Okay, Jim, why don't you look also? What do you see?
I see the it's almost the reticle is almost on the peg.
Okay, use these three screws to aim it precise. The instrument will move, and it is perfect on the thing. No.
No.
Yeah, there's a third one here.
Can hold the pen and paper?
You can move it in three dimensions. Ah, he found out it's easier without glasses. There's
except now I have to
thousands and thousands of dollars of optics in there, so it works better than your glasses. And you have a wider field of vision as well without glasses.
Okay, well, I say it's dead on.
Oh, is dead on? Is dead on? No. I'm sure if you can see, you can see. I say it's dead on too. Okay, so now, you can have a look too. Sorry.
Perfect.
Okay, so you put the thing in the right place, more or less, and you aim at the spike. So now we have the following situation. This thing is looking at that spike, but not at all horizontal, right?
No.
So we want it. This thing won't even work if it's not horizontal. That's a safety mechanism. So if it's not horizontal, you can't take a measurement, so you can never take a wrong measurement. It has to be horizontal. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to move this thing. We're going to imagine that this instrument is on the surface of a big sphere. That spike is in the center of the sphere. This thing is on the surface. And we want to move this instrument over the surface of the sphere it was keep looking at that, no matter where we move it. It will always look at the spike, wherever you move it. And in one place, and one place only, it will be looking at that spike and horizontal. Right, does that make sense? If you move this around like on a, so somewhere here or something, or here, it is, it will keep looking at that thing because it's on a sphere. This we are going to achieve. We have a little friend here. There's two bubbles. There's a bullseye bubble, which is over here, which we're going to ignore. And there's a real spirit level over here. This is our friend and our enemy. It's our friend because it helps us to level the instrument. It's our enemy because it's extremely sensitive. It's, it doesn't like to be fooled around this. So, yeah, there's a little bubble here. So what we're going to do is we're going to play with the legs. If you shorten or lengthen these legs, the thing will move over the surface and they'll keep looking at that thing. So let me guess, let's start with this leg. So you put a level, this level, there's only one, this level. You put it in the plane of action of this leg, so somewhere over here.
Maybe could you stand on the other side of the leg?
Yeah, I can't because I can't see it. I can, but
or do a different leg first.
No. This I can. So you put this spirit level in the plane of action of this leg. So if I now make this leg longer or shorter, it affects the spirit level, right? So you step on it, otherwise you pull it out of the ground, and you unlock it, and you bring it up a little bit because I know it wants to go up. And you look at, you keep your eye on this. Yeah, there's plenty of legs to go around. So see something like this, right? Caitlin, why don't you try this leg? You have to put your foot on it, otherwise you pull it out.
Okay.
And you move it, and you unlock it, and you have to...
Wait, shouldn't it be turned a little bit more?
Maybe a little bit, that's not... I would put this hand lower down, so you can control the movement of this thing. Like, you can either do it with this, you can do it like this, with your thumb. Find out it is extremely sensitive. Like, a millimeter will completely upset it. It's just a matter of doing it 100 times and it's of course automatic.
It's
very sensitive. I know, that's the whole point.
If you want to tell me when I can flip down there.
That's why I always bring our deep. But he can.
Because he's done it so
many. No, he can flip it. No, he doesn't many times.
Why can't I do it?
Because it is very sensitive.
It's okay, there you go.
Okay.
Oh, it moved.
No, it will move again, don't worry. Lock it. And you go try that one then. I locked it.
Oh.
Yeah.
How does one lock and unlock?
Oh, that's the next step. But the next step.
Okay.
You have to put your foot on it so it doesn't come out of the ground or moves away.
It is sensitive.
It's
right over to the edge.
It is a sensitive bubble.
With almost a hint of movement.
This is the tricky step. Let me see when it's a bullseye. I'm doing very well actually.
We have to readjust.
So you must give it a try. Then you'll try this one again. You have to put your foot on it. It's a bit of a gymnastic thing. You have to look at this bubble at the same time. And you can't really move the bubble. Okay, just a little. One stiff leg, but
I think I got it.
Should be that stiff. Yeah, just go that way. Yeah, just go a bit more. It is very sensitive. Oh, too much. Yeah, it's very sensitive, I know.
But that's good to get used to. It's hard to push down.
Yeah, just lock it. We do the rest on another way. Just lock it. No, you didn't mess it up.
Okay,
it feels like it because that bubble is so sensitive, but I can see that it's not so bad. Just lock it.
Okay.
Okay.
There we go.
Are you happy?
Yeah.
Okay,
sure.
check the theory. Did it move away from our spike? Check it.
It should have.
No, check it. It shouldn't have. In theory, it shouldn't.
Oh, that's interesting.
In theory, because it's moving on the surface of the sphere and it keeps looking at the center.
Yeah.
This looks straight down into the center, so it shouldn't move. But of course, it's not completely frictionless and it's not bad. Okay, so we put the thing over the spike. We put it precisely on the spike. You can check it. It's moved a little bit, but it's not. And so now it is almost horizontal and almost looking at the spike, right? Both are a little bit off still. So we concentrate on the horizontality now. The next step we do is we have the same bubble and we now put it in the plane of action of two of these screws. You always move two screws at the same time and you'll always move them in counter direction. So you move them either like this or you move them like this. If you remember the cartoon of the guy who builds a table and the table is wobbly, and you saw one leg that wobbles this way, you saw another leg that wobbles this way, and you keep going down until you reach the ground, right? So you'd have the same if you do one screw. The thing will just go up or go down, and it will never be right. So you put the bubble in the plane of the two screws, and you turn them to put the thing in the center. As soon as you touch one of these, as soon as you turn one of these, of course you move away from your spike. But we're going to ignore that for now. This is very easy because these screws are very, very fine threaded. So you put it perfectly in the center, right? Eco, right? You try this one. Just always in counter direction. Either the same display or the same. And also the same number of turns. Yeah. So of course you do this one. I do this one and you do this one also. So this fight helps. Tim, it should be.
Boy, that's even sense.
Yeah, but that's easy because these things have a very fine thread. They're easily controlled.
I
usually do 1, 2, 3 legs and then the first one again, and then 1, 2, 3 of these screws and then the first one again. So you go round plus one, and then it's usually okay. So now we can check how where we are. It's a bit out of focus for me, but have a look at this. How bad we did.
Okay, so it's a little.
Yeah. Okay, so we have achieved horizontality. We haven't achieved being over the point yet. So what you now do, these things in principle, I mean this thing is of course not horizontal, it's at a kind of an angle, slope, and this is exactly the same slope. That's why it's horizontal, right? What you can do now is you can look in here, you can unscrew it again, a little bit, and you can move it around over the table. Right? Check it.
Perfect.
So now we have reached our goal, horizontality. The instrument is horizontal, at least the bit above these screws, and it's looking at that point. So
how come we didn't just move it around before we were removing the legs?
Move it around before removing the legs.
Yeah, but we were moving the legs to get it over the dot. Why wouldn't we just move the top to get it over?
I'll say that again. We did that. We move it over the point as good as we could. If you move it over here, of course, you'll never see that. So you move it over the point as good as you can. You use the screws to aim it perfectly. So you're over the point. Then you start worrying about horizontality. You do the legs, you do the screws, and then you start worrying about the point again. So you look, and this table, of course, is like this big.
Right.
So you can move it maybe.
This is the same. You gotta be close enough.
Yes, because
then you can move.
This is a scale 1-to-1. So this thing moves maybe 2 centimeters here and here and here. So you have to be in this thing to do that trick. Otherwise it won't work. This is scale 1-to-1. I mean, there's no.
Yeah.
You move it. So if you cannot do it. Horizontality is key. If you're not completely over that point, the error you make is exactly this error, maybe a centimeter. Mm-hmm. If you have the horizontality wrong, you're screwed, because if your angles are wrong, everything is wrong. But this thing, all the electronic instruments that don't even work if it's horizontal. As soon as that inside here is three prisms hanging from a string, and the prism just dangle, so they're always like a plumb up. They're always vertical. And so it corrects the last bit itself, and if it's too far off, the prism hits the side and there's a contact and it says I can't correct for horizontality, and then it switches off. You see an error or whatever, you see a bee on this thing. Which means I can't do it.
That happened last year.
Which is a good thing. It's a good thing because then you cannot take a wrong measurement.
Right.
The instrument is always, if it's set up properly, it will do it. If you, if it reads an instant, a reading is always correct. You may be in the wrong point or something, maybe something like that, but the readings that the thing does is always correct. Because of that. Okay. So we achieved the first thing we wanted to achieve. And now you can switch it on. Try that. So it starts up the program. And what does it say?
0 cents.
Yeah, so the old instruments, including this one, they needed to be, you need to wake them up. So you have to turn this thing full circle. This telescope, yeah? No, no, the telescope itself. The whole thing.
The whole thing.
Ah.
Like this, and now it switches on. Okay, so it starts at, it should start at zero, but for some reason it likes 59, it's the same as zero, it's like 1 second difference. Okay, so now we have to worry about what are we actually measuring? What are we actually measuring? Because I say angles and distances, but how does that work? Let me see, do it in the right order. It will come back later, but this thing measures two angles. It measures the horizontal angle on this plane, right? And the vertical angle on this plane, right? The first thing you have to worry about is, what is a full circle? How far does it go? Is that 2 pi? Is it 360 degrees or 400 grads? And the next thing you have to worry about is, where is zero? What is zero? You measure from where? An angle is 3 things, right? You measure from A to this, to me, to something else. Where is zero? How do you find that out? I would say...
Maybe you go to something you know.
No, I would just turn the telescope. You turn it in.
Or do you set it arbitrarily?
No. Not the verticality. The verticality is easy. Okay, so there's different law, schools of thought. You can say horizontal is, as the name says, the horizon. So horizontal is horizontal. Or you can say a plumbob is horizontal, so straight down is horizontal. It depends on your school of thought, right? So you just turn the telescope, you make it look straight up, and you read zero is straight up. Just by this instrument, zero is straight up.
Okay.
So straight down will be 180. So horizontal will be?
9.
Or?
270.
Ah! That's the key thing to remember. This instrument is equipped, like all crazy Topcons, with 2 screens on both sides. So if you're not completely familiar with the instrument, you can read it upside down. And if you're not confused by the strange business of controls, 270 is horizontal, so all your readings will be upside down. Which is easy to fix, but it is a bit of a... I don't know why they built two displays on these things. Topcon always does that. But it's confusing. So you have to remember that you can see the spirit level and you can see the vertical control, whatever. You have to get a feel of the instrument and remember that it is upside down. This one especially, because you turn it to start it, if you turn it not a full circle, but a circle and a half, you end up upside down and it is working and you think everything is okay, right?
So you have to be on the bob side.
You have to be aware of that. So if you do the readings and everything turns out funky, they're all right, but I did it upside down. It's all the place, the right place, they're just upside down. So okay, so that was the horizontal angle, the vertical angle. That you just flip that here. So this is V for vertical, H for horizontal. So you press it, you get the horizontal angle. So what is the horizontal circle? Where is the zero? And then Dim comes in.
A known point?
A known point. Right, a known point. So we just grab a known point. Let me see how... The best one would be that point. There's a point of the hill there, but it's not completely... I know where there is a point. There is one up the hill there. Okay, if you look for this thing, there is, Dim, you have to come on this side so you can see what's going on. There is 2 controls here. This little thing focuses the crosshairs. So in there, there's a crosshairs, there's 2 down, 1 up, and 2 horizontal. Then make a cross in the middle, which is what you aim at, like a gun sight. So you focus that with this. Since everybody has different eyes, you have to first focus the crosshairs. And then the picture, the image you see, you focus with the big screw on the outside, right? Have a try, have a look. you have to focus the crosshair first, so you can see what you're aiming at, mm-hmm. and then you focus the picture. And you'll probably see a piece of concrete sticking out, a rebar sticking out of the ground.
I guess I do.
Oh, I guess I do.
Well, I don't know, I'm not sure.
Well, I can see it with the naked eye, so...
There's something out there.
Okay. Caitlin, have a try. Shut up! Is it still too high for you?
Yeah, well, you measured it from this side, but it's on the slope. I don't know if I could see.
We can move it around, it doesn't matter. Yeah.
Okay, I don't see anything.
No, because I turned it. First focus the crosshair. That's the first thing you focus. And then you focus the picture.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't see the thing. I mean, I see grass.
Oh, that's fine too. It's okay. Frost. Let me go give it a try.
What's this second ring? There's
a that's just to take the thing apart.
Oh, okay. So don't turn that one.
Yeah, it's pretty tight. I don't think you can easily turn that one. So you focus the crosshair, so you see the reticle, and then you focus the image.
Yeah.
Okay. So then. Let me see how we easily instruct it. I have to put my thing out. I think that's the best way. I put it in a place convenient for Caitlin. Okay, once you have found your point that you want to set as the zero is just a 360 circle, you can turn the circle and you put the zero at whatever you want. Right? It's very easy to just press, there's a button here that says, it's on this side, just press zero set. Right, so if you press this, look at the screen, it will flip to zero. But it doesn't like zero, it always flips to 99 or something.
Yeah, almost.
Yeah, that's almost zero anyway. Sometimes it likes it. There's some internal thing that doesn't like that.
Yeah, it seems to jump.
Yeah, but this is second, so it's extremely sensitive. So if you tap it, it will also jump. So that's very, very small angles. So that's how you set your horizontal zero. The vertical zero is fixed, just straight up, or straight down, or straight horizontal. That's fixed. The horizontal zero you can set to wherever you want. And you want to set it at a known point, either north or a point on your one of these markers, right? So that's the angle measurement. And now we need the distance measurement. I will make this loose. Okay, try to find the target. You will quickly find out the problem.
Yeah, I'm looking at it like a tiny distance, right?
That's also a bit close, I agree, but that's... Otherwise
okay,
I had to walk too far.
Ground.
Yeah. Okay, one thing to remember. One thing to remember, on top here and also below here,
uh-huh.
There's a white if you look through that thing, there's a white triangle. And the triangle looks at exactly the same thing as the telescope looks at. Do you see the triangle?
No.
You have to it only works.
Yeah.
It's like magic. It appears magically. And the triangle looks at the same thing as the telescope. So if you see
there you go. All right, I see the thing now.
I see the thing. What is the problem? Oh, no. What do you see? Let me see. Oh yeah, this is. I just shut Ben's eyes now, so you know you have to focus it a little bit. Try to aim it at the center of the target,
which is where the V's are pointing.
Yeah, yeah. If you see, there's the little glass thing. There's six lines. Or
okay, it's not pointed exactly at me.
No, that's okay.
Okay.
Don't you find it difficult to keep it still? That's the question. It says you start pressing buttons.
I guess. I mean, I'm not pushing it.
No. Give me your hand. Look at the thing. Look for
okay.
The thing. Give me your hand. This thing, the outside.
Oh.
the outside, if you turn it all the way. Yeah. This thing, all the way. Yeah, until it stops. Right?
Yeah.
Now it doesn't move anymore. And then this thing moves it on the, this thing inside, mm-hmm. moves it over the wire. Unless you reach the end of the wire. I think you've done it. Let's try like this. At some point there's an end. You see careful movement.
Yeah.
And the same here for the vertical. So the big one locks it.
Okay.
And the small one moves over the plane of action. Right?
Cool. So then I want him to be with the X over the center of
the X over there's three lines that cross, intersect. You want the X over that thing.
Okay,
let somebody else try it now.
I'm just learning.
No, there's three people. You have to be social about it.
Hans has to be extraordinarily patient about it.
No. You see the triangle?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And if you then look through the telescope, you see supposed to see the same thing. That's vertical. This one is horizontal.
Okay, let's see. This is horizontal. Out of range.
So you can move it by hand. And if you lock it, you can move it with the screw. If it's unlocked, the screw doesn't catch, doesn't work. So you have to either push it around or screw it around.
Unlock this one. No, lock it.
Lock it and then the screw works, the screw catches. Yeah. The gun sight. Okay.
I like that little sight. They really were quite clever when they made this.
Oh yeah, yeah. There's a few hundred. There's
the
like years, 100
they
years.
Actually followed the suggestions.
100 year
of people
experience
in the
yeah.
field.
Yeah.
It seems like. I can see.
They never could really do it in America. They never built proper instruments. It's always Europe or Japan.
How precise does it have to be?
Well, I suppose it can be spot on. Desire. If nobody, if a person is holding it, of course, it will move around a little bit. Especially if the wind is up or the person had too many martinis. Okay, how is this? Yeah. So now we know the angle. We have a random grid now. So this is the horizontal angle. So the only thing we need to know now is the distance, right?
Well, we have to set zero.
Yeah, we did that. So it's random for now, but we can do it properly.
And to do it, one would push this one, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So now it goes back to zero. Okay, so the distance is measured by a laser or infrared that shoots out here, hits the mirror, and comes back. And from the phase shift, it can calculate the distance. Right? So you just press a little triangle down there. This little triangle. Yeah, somebody has to press it. So they start measuring. It's a C for measuring. And they'll measure it a couple of times. And it will spit back an answer. Okay, 17 meters, 45 centimeters, or 4 millimeters. And it will do it again. Okay, so that is measured from the center of the instrument, which is halfway between this little thing and this little thing. And this is the distance from here to that mirror. Is that the distance we want to know? Probably not, otherwise I wouldn't ask the question. Let me switch it because it keeps measuring. So, but we just said, or I just said, you want to project everything on a piece of paper that is horizontal. This thing, of course, is way higher than that thing. I can even tell it from here. But do we want to know that distance, or do we want to know something else?
And we want to know the distance if that were the same height as this.
Exactly. So how do we know that distance? Or we don't?
Mathematics must come in.
Some sort of
miracle occurred.
But this is no. Okay. What would be the answer to this?
I guess you need to know the height of the rod or the mirror and the height of the instrument.
I I can easily measure those, but it doesn't. How does that help me?
Well, then you would know the difference between them. Yeah, but we don't know the difference.
Let me make a little sketch here. Let me make a little sketch here. Okay, so this is our slope, right? We are, say, here. This is our instrument. This is our target. Or I think, no, but so we measure this, right? Yeah, it's not properly drawn. We measure this. This is called, in jargon, it's called SD, for slope distance. We don't want to know that. We want to project this all down to a piece of paper, this piece of paper. So we want to project it down to here, right? This is called HD, for horizontal distance. So how do we know the horizontal distance? This is what we want to know. We want to project it down to a plane.
If you knew this distance, you could.
Yeah, if you do, but we don't know that. Because there's a big mountain here that we can't know that. Because that is exactly what we want to know.
The slope distance and the vertical angle.
Yeah. That's exactly why this thing measures that angle. It measures the horizontal angle, which we're interested in, but it also measures the vertical angle. And the vertical angle it measures for exactly that reason. This angle here, that's called phi, is also measured. This is this one. Is 4 degrees 25 minutes 38 seconds. So how then do we do that? This is correct, but how do we do that?
The sine.
Yeah, almost right, it's the cosine. So HD equals slope distance time cosine of phi, right? And then this thing equals the sine of phi. And out of a problem came an advantage, because this is the vertical distance, this is the elevation of that thing. So with the horizontal angle and the distance, we can measure x and y. And the vertical distance and the slope distance gives us the z. So every point is measured as z. You have an x, y, z coordinate. So this what started as a problem, because we don't want the slope distance, we want the horizontal distance, turned into an advantage. Because now we have this point measured, and we also know its elevation over the height of this instrument. Right? So that's how it works. You measure two angles and one distance, and that's enough. So you have to know where these points are.
This is VD. SD,
yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Sine.
Vertical distance, yeah. Yeah. So the sine times the vertical angle times the slope distance is the elevation. And the cosine is the horizontal distance, the true distance. Of course, this thing is maybe, in its day, was like $8,000 or something. But they don't expect us to do this. If you press this button, it'll measure it again, because this thing doesn't, it keeps measuring. This is okay. And you can see the little indicator here that measures the slope distance. If you press the button again, it'll give you the horizontal distance, right? This is the indicator. So this is the true horizontal distance, 17.4, that's, or 399. If you press it again, you get the vertical distance. So it's 1.3 meters. Yeah, but it's very simple math, right? That's very simple
that,
math.
But still, it's very clever.
That's very simple math.
Posterity.
Maybe she's obvious. Okay, so the way this instrument doesn't remember that stuff. So it just shows, it throws down to you on the display, and you have to write it down. And you can do it in many ways, but what the way it's set up here, which is fine, there's nothing wrong with that, is that the spreadsheet takes horizontal angle and then all the three distances. So you need to write down the horizontal radius, and you have to press this three times to do the three distances.
And how do we figure out the horizontal radius?
Oh, this just gives it to you.
No, but which button? Is it
this
VH?
One? Yeah, it goes back to this. Yeah. So what I usually do, if that were somebody holding a stick, I press this, and it measures, and I write down whatever it is. I come back to this. It was 15 something. I write down slope distance. I press it. I write down horizontal distance. I press it. I write down vertical distance, and I say, okay, I got it. And then I press this, and if this thing doesn't move, you can write down the angle. So in the time that this person moves to the next point, I can write down the angle, and then I can find them again. So that's the quickest way to do it. You can do it the other way around if you want. You can do write the angle first, and then distances, but it's faster to do it the other way around. Of course, as soon as you move this, that angle disappears, so you have to do it before you move. Anyway, sometimes you forget, you say go back to the previous point, that's fine. I don't know what you're doing. And contrary to what you would think, the guy with the stick is the boss, right? Because he or she puts the sticks down, that's what measures. This thing just takes the measurement. This thing, and the guy here, I can't see what is happening over there. If it's completely wrong or somewhere I don't want it, I can check that. So the guy in charge is the guy with the stick. But that's why I always carry the stick and have somebody else press the button. It's also very boring.
So it looks like the stick height has nothing to do.
That's not completely true. That's not completely, what this does, it measures from this thing to this thing. And you want to drop it down to the ground, right? You want to go to the ground. Yeah. So you have to write down four things. If you start taking measurements, we will do that right away. You have to say set up over, and you write down the number of this thing. It's 18, 19. Right? Mm-hmm. You can find that what the coordinates are. And then you call something that's called, and write it out, back side. Right? Mm-hmm. That's your back side, is where you set your zero. We're gonna do that thing over there. So that'll be 001. Right? It's your write down. So you know where you are and you know where your zero is. You need it. And then you write down the height of your instrument. You measure that. And you write down the height of the target.
How do we know the height of the instrument?
You just measure this. In my box is a secret tool.
A secret tool.
Yeah. Measure. So you just measure it from the top of the stake, the top of the stake where you put your stick, to this circle here. So this is 57 in this case. Sorry.
Okay, so it's not some.
It's not the ground. It's the top of the stick.
No, because you put your stick there.
Right.
This 50. No, this the center of the center. Say 56, 55 and a half. Whatever. I'm excited for that to be.
How precise do you normally do it?
I do it to the centimeter. Yeah. You will find out quickly enough that the vertical, the elevations is the problem. This thing is, for reasons that are quite obvious, if you look at this again. So this angle is always very, very small. So this sign will be very, very big. So there will be if you move it a little bit, it only changes a little bit. The vertical angle is always very small, and it remains very small. But 10 degrees is like all the way down already, so it's between like 5 and 5. So there's very little variation. So the error you make, they carry on into your vertical distance. And horizontal distance, of course, it's huge angles, it's like 180 degrees, 270 degrees, it's all the whole circle you use. But the inaccuracy is always in the elevations. That's why they still use levels. The level is way more accurate than this thing is, but it's also way more time consuming. So a level is basically a field light where this thing is fixed. So this is fixed at 90 degrees and it can't move anymore. You just read from the stick. Like you do with a relay. Yeah. That is way more accurate. Certainly over long distances and small elevational differences. Okay, that's basically how it works. I'm gonna write it all down. So I already wrote down parts of it. But I'll make a nice little thing that remains comprehensible.
That'd be great. In terms of the setup, that's everything we need to write down. The heights of the two things, the back sight.
Yeah, you need four things. So you need to know where you are.
The number, right?
Yeah, that will later be coordinates, that's too much. But so you have, the number corresponds with the coordinates, and then you need the number of the backside, so you know where you look back to.
Right.
Yeah? But that could be like another one of these.
Yeah, that's not going to develop there or something. Yeah. Any point that you know the coordinates of, as long as you know the coordinates, it's okay. You can use some temporary point as well. It doesn't matter. As long as you know, you have to know the coordinates, so you have to know the number of the points, so you can look back in the list what the corners are. You have to know how high this thing is. What is it, 1.56? And you have to know how high that stick is. The stick of there's a liter on the stick itself.
Oh, and on the stick one has to be careful because I think there's also feet.
There's also feet.
So yeah. It has to be sure to use the meters.
There's also feet. And for obvious reasons, that stick, the lower it is, the more accurate. If I show it to you. The guy with the stick, he has to, or he or she has to find the right point whenever you want to survey. You poke it down when you want to survey, and then you have to keep this bubble as central as you can. And you can imagine if you, that's very difficult, especially if there's a wind or whatever, if it moves a little bit, it's okay. But if a stick is huge, it's like this, and you move it a little bit, it's like huge up there, right? So.
Yeah. Yeah.
This thing, of course, measures it's millimeter accuracy. If the guy with the stick is doing like this, your millimeter accuracy is not going to help you much. Because that's. It also the elevation will change, right? It will go lower if you go back. So. But the lower this is, the better. And 150 is just because it is the first one and easy to remember. You want to put it all the way down if you want. That's how it works.
So that's 1.5 meters.
Yeah, it says here. Sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
It says here, it says meters. And this goes up, so this is 2 meters. You can go all the way up if you want. And here, as Eco said, there's also feet on this side. And it's also a warning somewhere that if you do it under a power line, you should be careful not to touch the power line. It's for the American markets. See?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. This is aluminum, but if you touch the power line, you will die. Okay.
Okay, so once we're at the back side of that, then you could just hit the points one after the other.
Yeah, that's got 4 sides. Yeah, so you do one back side, all the other points are 4 sides. You just go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 to infinity.
And you write down those 4 things for each one.
You write also down for every point you measure, you write also down, of course. Let me see. For each point that you measure, yeah. So you write, this is the basics. You have the setup, this is called the occupied point. Occupied point. And this is the back side. The height of the instrument, height of the target. And then for each point you write down the ID, so you know what the point is, otherwise you forget. Whatever point, you want to measure this again or something. And you measure down, you write down the horizontal radius, which is called here the angle. It gives it to you, yeah?
And then you push the button.
And you write down slope distance, horizontal distance, vertical distance.
And then the angle.
Oh, the angle. No, the angle.
That was the first. Yeah, okay. Yeah. But if you do that one last, to save time, just, you threw me off.
But I do it like this, to save time in the enter the data. That doesn't matter. I mean, you can see what Patricia and she use like pages and pages, and she wrote it down like this. That's fine too. I mean, yeah. as long as you know what it means.
Right.
I'm a bit more, that's fine. I mean, whatever.
I have extra books for you.
Yeah, but it's also like you keep flipping the pages. And also make notes now and again. You make a little sketch. So this sketch is a room in the palace. It's room B3. We did 0.125.26. So you can make a little sketch to show where it is. And the sketch that becomes a little joint. Whatever. So you have to keep track of what you're doing. Otherwise,
you
come home with a whole bunch of numbers and don't know what they are.
Right.
Okay, somebody has to walk up there. Can we see that from here? I guess we can. Under that Syrian, yeah, I think it's to the left of that metal thing, I hope. Under that Syrian thing is a concrete circle with a point like this in it.
Can you put this other point?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I have a couple questions first, maybe before we start doing the practical.
Sure.
First of all, a backside, creating one of the cement points, like this one.
Yeah.
What does that involve more than regular?
In principle, you should do what they call a balanced traverse. You should go from this to all your unknowns and then back to this.
All of our knowns.
All the unknowns. You go from this to that one to that one to that one, and you make like a.
So if this one were, no, okay. So if this one were the new point you were putting in, what would
would.
Oh, you don't stand on this one. You just locate it.
Oh, you never stand on this one.
If it's new,
say Muhammad had just put this one in.
Yeah, no, well, you don't stand on it. No, you don't stand on that. No, you stand on another one.
And you look at this.
Yeah.
And then now
is there, what is it, just that you put it in cement that's important, or do you do any special kind of measurement?
No. It is only reason it is in cement is that it's. That it stays where it is, it doesn't move. Although some are loose, but.
But it, wasn't Barbara doing something so that there was greater accuracy or precision or something with these ones?
Yeah, that's what I said. You should do a balance traverse. So you should go from this one to your unknowns and back to this one, and then you get like a polygon, and you can tie it. You can get it more accurate. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. But we're not going to do that. We're just going to do it from here and from somewhere else. If you use this point and that point, and then use that point and that point, and we just do it from two directions.
But just in theory, if Muhammad had just put this one in, we would go
to another one.
To say like three or four points, known points, and look at this
one. Right, exactly.
And then we would take
you see if they're the same.
But you see if they're the same.
And you average them out. Yeah.
Okay.
But they should first be...
extremely close.
They should be extremely close. They will be extremely close.
Okay. Then the second question is laying out squares. It's something different than what we're doing.
Oh yeah, that's easy though. I can easily show that. So laying out a square, you have to. This is in the corner of your square now, like we have over there. We had those things already in situ, right?
Okay.
You just know where your corner is. You put this thing up like we did. So this is right over that.
This on top of the corner.
Yeah, above the corner of the trench. Okay. Right, and then you just turn this thing until it reaches 90. Let me try to do that. 90. This is so. And put it into the wire. Right, you can put exactly at 90.
Yeah, okay, that's exactly it.
Yeah, you got exactly that. It's easier. And then you just hook a tape. And if you look for this now, you look exactly 90 degrees from this angle.
To this point. Okay.
Yeah. And then you turn it this way for the whatever, 180, or so you can do from one corner, you can do two directions.
Two lines, okay.
Yeah. And then you move it one up, and you do the other lines. And then over there, you had this. Let me. You had the old trenches here, or trenches, squares, whatever, with their points.
Right.
So you set up over here. You look back at this one. You do 90 this way, and 90 this way, 180 this way. And you put 5, 10, 15.
And you do that with the tape?
You do it with the tape, yeah. If it is not too windy, too steep, you can easily do it with the tape. You can do it with the target, but I think the tape.
So you look through the stick and you just look for the 5 meter.
Yeah, you see the tape coming out.
Right, yeah.
And you see it not on the crosshair. So you tell this guy you have to go that way, and he goes that way.
Uh-huh.
And you say you have to go that way, and he goes that way. And in the end, he's smacking along the crosshair.
So you move him in the horizontal plane.
Yeah, you move those about
the vertical plane is set by the 5 meter tape.
Yeah, exactly. So you have the tape.
Except maybe Barbara had, I recall, some corrections if... you were on a slope.
Well, on the slope you have to correct for the that's the same problem as this. You have to correct for the angle of the slope.
But what you could do is you would just set up the target.
Yeah, but the problem with the target, of course, is that I think that at 5 meters the tape is more accurate than the target. I think, because this thing is like a meter and a half over the ground and it is moving around. I mean, maybe it won't be more accurate.
Okay.
I think the tape will be more accurate.
Slopes up, you would.
Oh no, no! The shortest distance is always shorter. It's up or down doesn't matter. Up or down doesn't matter. It's the same.
So you
have to correct for. You have to correct for the.
Take a few off. Or
always off. Always off. Always off. The slope distance is always longer by definition. So I always have to take it off.
And there's some sort of a table she had, or something like that, or.
Oh, I don't know. It's just the cosine of the angle, so. Yeah, I can make such a table, but it's not much.
I think she had some.
Oh, maybe she made one. It's possible.
I mean, it's not important to the discussion, but remember what used to happen.
And of course, after you lay them out, you locate them. You locate them precisely. So as soon as you start hammering them in, they also move. So they will never be in exactly the right spot. So you put them in as best as you can, and then later you just survey them in, and then you know exactly where they are, even though they're not on the right. Not exactly where you want them, but then it will be like 2 centimeters either way or something. Won't be a lot. So,
okay. Yes. And the last question is: if for the outer city survey, is there anything? No, it's a longer discussion. Yeah. Is there anything that we need to do differently in terms of machine and mirror for a survey where the mirror is very far away? Or
well, this works maybe 200 meters or something accuracy. At some point,
it's only accurate to 200 meters.
At some point, you walk far away, and it just loses signal. It doesn't do it at all anymore. And then, if you walk closer, at some point, it will start reading, but the readings won't be so accurate. And there's no way of telling where it becomes within the range of your accuracy. Nobody knows. But there is, you can buy more targets. So what they do is they have one, or they have three in the triangle, or have 10 in the triangle. So, but.
And by having more targets, it makes it more accurate.
Yeah, it makes it more accurate. Yeah, get a stronger signal back. But
and
I think for archaeology, I never run out of range.
Well, but if somebody was at the top point, and the target, the farthest the target could be would be 500 meters.
You have to try it. I don't know. Yeah.
And how much of an accuracy is lost?
Well, the angle will be more accurate or as accurate. It's the distance will be the problem. I have no idea. I don't think anybody knows that. I don't think so.
And if one were to buy new a thing with 3 or 5, would it?
It always fits on that stick. Yeah.
It would always fit on the stick, and it would be good for any top con or.
Oh, the targets are all the same. Yeah, it says here you have the only thing that it says -3, so you have to set that in the instrument.
As the offset.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's standard. No, these targets are all the same.
They're all the same, and they would work with any machine.
They would work with any machine. Okay. Yeah, they would work with any machine. They're all the same. And these wires are all the same for all instruments. It's very convenient. Also, different GPSs. All survey instruments have the same wiring. They're all interchangeable to sticks and tripods and things. That's very